think there's quite a few things that can be said about Ephesians. We're in, I don't know, probably our 12th session or something like that. I started to go into some things tonight about what's going on this week. And I really felt like the Lord spoke to me most of the night about something that he really put on my heart. That kind of, okay, Lord, you give me a different signal here. I guess I need to change course to follow you, which is imperative, to follow him, to capture his heart and his mind, and to bring that into ourselves so that we can stay connected to him. I mean, our whole life we're supposed to be connected to him, and that's our reasonable, prudent duty, is to stay connected to him, be in the family of God, and listen to him. And of course, with that comes the duties of being sons and daughters of God, but also it places us under his care, and now he has certain duties to us. And I hope you don't push the envelope for those reasons. But my goodness, it's a delightful reason to serve my God. I hope you get pleasure out of serving your God. Pleasures out of doing his will. And pleasures out of performing his word. We're supposed to be receiving great pleasure out of performing his word. Our Lord Jesus was consummately the happiest man on earth. That's what the scripture says. Filled with joy all the time. He was not restrained in his emotions like we are. He was not subdued with the events of life and kings and the Roman Empire. He was not subdued in his worship of his God. His kingdom was truly in his Father's presence, and as a result, he didn't have the emotional entanglements that we do peer to peer, mother and father, husband and wife, brother and sister. He always stayed in perfect accord with his Father and was able to express his heart and the heart of the Father in perfect accord to all of his unilateral horizontal relationships here on earth. He's a little bit different than us in that respect, but that's the character that the Holy Spirit is trying to bring us into. So this magnificent work that the Holy Spirit has written, the book of Ephesians, begins to illuminate to us so many factors that will cause us to be able to stay in relationship with Jesus. We're going to cover a few of those in this session. And my thoughts wrap around this in a passage of Scripture. If you want to read with me for a moment in Ephesians, in page 1 of your notes, Ephesians chapter 1, verse 15. Therefore, I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all the saints, do not cease to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you a spirit of wisdom, a spirit of revelation, and the knowledge of him. He's praying also that the eyes of our understanding will be enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling? What are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints? And what is the exceeding greatness of his power towards us who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in heavenly places, far above all principalities and powers and might and dominion, and every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in that which is to come. And he pulled all things under his feet, and gave him to be head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. There's so much in there, I think we could spend weeks upon weeks upon weeks, because this is like opening a treasure chest of God expressing his heart, about God opening and showing the power that is present. It was no small thing. It had never been done before. I don't know what it took for God to take the power and take dimensions and take Jesus into one dimension, rescue those who are in that dimension, bring him out of that dimension, the power it took to subdue the enemy in the midst of that, the power it took to redeem all of mankind, the power it took for the full manifestation of the glory of God in the place of darkness, the place of the dead. We're talking one manifestation of God after another in realms that we have not much knowledge about. And everything I quoted to you has come out of Scripture, not out of some book or some commentary. So he's trying to express to us, the writer of this letter, the Holy Spirit, here's what your calling is. Here's what your life is supposed to be about. And he puts it on Paul's heart, which is the apostle to you and I. He's the apostle to the Gentiles. Puts it upon his heart. Let them know what they need. Speak to them about what's available. Bring revelation to them and speak to them about the wisdom of the Holy Spirit and what the Holy Spirit can bring. And so Paul is on his face interceding. The man whose mere shadow, if it passes over a handkerchief, can be laid on somebody that has a broken spine and be healed. Somebody that doesn't have eyes and be healed. Our God was making himself manifest and has not stopped since then. And if that person is praying for us by the power of the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit is saying, you pray for them, not only in this age, but the age to come, that they'll be able to receive and perceive the presence and the power and the magnificence of our great God and who we are. Now, the reason I'm elaborating on this is because we're going to go up into some definitions. These are not just mere words that are thrown on the table. These are God in action with might and power behind it and giving us a derision and showing us, just like that power that raised Christ from the dead and did all of those magnificent things, let them know he's in their midst right now. The same power that raised him is at work. The same power is available for them to call upon. The same power for them to come into relationship with the Father, because the whole paraphrase is given that Jesus was brought into full relationship with the Father and was brought to the throne room of the Father and was brought and seated with the Father. And he says, tell them that same power is the power of God that is work here and now. He's nice. Tell you this is because most of theology doesn't believe that. I read out of several different books today, sadly. One which I really like, things this commentator has to say, shocked me. Quote, the baptism of the Holy Spirit is a historical event which occurred on three distinct occasions: at Jerusalem, baptizing the Jews into Christ's body; at Caesarea, baptizing the Gentiles into his body; at Ephesus, similarly baptizing the disciples of John the Baptist in Acts 2 and 1. Baptism in the Holy Spirit is not an experience to be sought by believers today. It is a historical event. Even as the incarnation of Christ was, the crucifixion, the resurrection, the ascension of Christ, which, on the exercise of genuine faith by an individual, that seals that person as a member of the body of God. What seals a person as part of God? He's saying their faith did. What does the Scripture say seals a person in the body of God? The Holy Spirit does. And I read that, I thought, dear God in heaven, these people have so much to say about other things. If they're not getting this, what is an error? And elsewhere, I'm almost afraid to use the word as a result of not seeing that the Holy Spirit is real, not seeing that the power of God is real, denying the power and the presence of God, saying it is history. He is no longer active. Signpost on the door of a university professor at a cemetery. Oh, did I trip there? Read like this. Jesus asked Peter, who do men say I am? And Peter responded, You are a supernatural manifestation of the ontology ground of being, a metaphysical Rubik's Cube by which our leap of faith is channeled into a help of societal dialectics. The Lord said, I'm who? And then he quoted, and he straightway charged him, tell no man concerning who he was. I almost want to talk to these spiritual suicide maniacs that come in and denigrate the power of God and tell no more who Jesus is. You do not know him. Tell no more about the greatness of our God. Tell no more. Talk no more. I don't want, my ears do not want to hear it, because you deny the presence of my God. You deny the voice of my God. You deny the power of my God. And without that, we are lost. Jesus is not a historical fact. The Holy Spirit is not a historical fact. My God is not a historical fact. There's a problem that lies in understanding this that maybe we can digress into. I'm probably an anomaly as far as my evangelical brothers are concerned, because I don't know, Babsmatic, Babdecostal, I don't know, it's one of those cross breeds in there, Pentebaptist. And I, early on, when I was 7 years old, had to make a tough decision. I kept hearing the music behind the music, the altar call. I kept listening to the preacher. I already knew Jesus existed. I already talked to him. I already prayed to him. I loved him with all my heart. But for some reason, to me, I thought that if I made him Lord of my life, I had to instantly leave my family and go to Africa and be a missionary. I was a serious thing. I wept for weeks emotionally, standing behind closed doors as a 7-year-old child throughout this house that we lived in, hiding from my mom, not wanting her to see my tears. How can I go to her and say, Mom, I've decided to leave you and give my life to God? How can I explain that to my dear brother that's just 18 months older than I and we're bosom buddies? How can I go express that to my father, who I lay on his shoulder and arm at night and he would tell me wonderful stories, who gave great amounts of love and attention and affection to me? How can I look my family in the eye and say, the call is so great, but when the music would play, my heart would just stump, my head would pound, and I would groan, oh God, oh Jesus, I want to come, I want, but how can I leave my family? Until finally, after about 6 weeks of that, I stood up on the pew, 7 years old, and wrapped my arms around my mother's neck, gushing tears uncontrollably, not being able to breathe, weeping profusely, and crawled down and walked down the aisle, not thinking I'm ever going to see my family again, going into the service of my God. When I got there to the altar, pastor asked me some questions. You make Jesus Lord of your life? Will you make it your life ambition to know him? And it's like a supernatural thing occurred. It's like the voice behind the music became real. God's voice broke through. God's voice embraced me. God surrounded me, his light, his pillar, his cloud. And I could just fell in it in joy. You are my God. You are my God. 7 years old. My evangelical brothers would have a problem with that. Why? Because, oh, you're just supposed to have faith and say these words. Your experience means nothing. It appears to me that Christ came to give men experience with God. It appears to me that God descended upon the earth and stood on the great mountain and gave the commands so that they could have an experience with a real living God. It's experiential, not based upon knowledge. I thought around this, and I didn't tell you where I had that experience, and it may be the problem of some of my theological cronies. It was in Roswell, New Mexico. UFO capital of the world, where people stand and say they saw little men and little spaceships. But who are those people that say those things? Who are these people that talk about weird stuff in the sky? And who are the people that talks about the conspiracy theory and aliens landing and all these things that brought, I want you to know, in the 50s, it brought great turmoil to our nation and to the world. It brought great fear. And Orson Welles did War of the Worlds over the radio nationally. Hundreds of people jumped to their death committing suicide, thinking that the world was coming to an end and the Martians had invaded the earth, because the show lasted for like 10 to 12 hours. My point being is there was a reality that was projected of something that was taking place that didn't take place. I have a reason for saying this, because there is a real Area 51 that the government said doesn't exist. Wouldn't admit that it exists. Matter of fact, Area 51 is nicknamed for a military base that is located in the southern portion of Nevada in the western United States, 83 miles northwest of downtown Las Vegas, situated at its center. On the north shore is Groom Lake. It goes on and talks about the base lies. It's a special testing and training range. They still barely acknowledge its existence. Other names used for it is Dreamland, Paradise Ranch, Home Base, Watertown Strip, Groomland. The most recent name that they've found is Homey Airport. I keep changing the name because this is supposed to be a special private place. Unfortunately, I saw a military satellite of a picture of it from 1974. Hopefully they won't show up and brainwash me. Didn't happen. Now, I want you to know that this place is called the Box because it's a container. It's got military things all around it. It's all got all kinds of jamming signals so nobody can photograph it, nobody can go there. And there's a reason. The deepest secrets of our nation are kept there. The deepest secrets of our weaponry is kept there. The deepest secrets of our defenses is kept there. Now, I don't know if you know it or not. If you like to keep a secret, it causes problems for some people out there, to where they speculate. The intense security surrounding the base and the very existence of which the U.S. government barely acknowledges made it the frequent subject of conspiracy theories and the central point of unidentified flying objects. They're still keeping the spaceship there. They really got the technology for the planes now off of a flying saucer that they had. Man, you wouldn't believe the headlines that came out and all the things that were being said, and every weirdo with tinfoil on their head and little antennas showed up. Oh, Area 51, they've got something. Now, I'm painting a picture for a reason. Who's painting that picture of Area 51? Those who do not have access to Area 51. The people who work at Area 51 get to see the greatest technological advances on Earth. They see real equipment that does real things. They see planes that can fly invisibly. They see every manner of radar there is, every manner of electronics there is, every manner of propulsion system that so far that's probably 30 years, 40 years beyond anything that we know of right now. Only the stuff we... The only stuff we know of is stuff that was developed maybe 20 to 30 years ago. We have no idea what's developed. I don't want to know. I don't want them to tell anybody. Why? Because that's for our defense. It's a secret. And my whole purpose in laying out this place for you, there is people who work there. There's people who have proven themselves that they will be faithful to our nation and can keep a secret even under torture, that knows what goes on there for our well-being. But now all the guys floating around the earth with the tinfoil on their head and the little antennas and saying worry, worry, and they're drawing pictures like they know. They're saying, what's going on? They're saying, oh, these weird things are there. I want you to know, in theological world, the manifestations of God, they're locked down on God's secret base. And the people with the weird antennas and the tinfoil hats don't have access to that information. The people who reject and want to use their own mind with their own understanding, and they do not want the infilling of the Holy Spirit, they do not want the presence of the Holy Spirit, they do not want the baptism of the Holy Spirit. The Scripture says these things are for spiritual minds and spiritual men, and those who do not have the Spirit have no access of it. So where does all the conflict come? It comes from those who are not allowed on the base. It comes from those who have never been there. It comes from those who have never experienced it. And then that raises up a whole nother crowd. Well, those people who say they've experienced and know Area 51 exists, there must be something wrong with them. But I ask you, these men and women who work on this base and have, since this base was developed, are they insane? Or do they deal with real facts and real things? I look at Area 51 as the area that God is calling us to. It's a special training place. It's a place with all the power and the mysteries of God upon it. And those who do not walk in the Spirit, cannot see in the Spirit, reject God's authority, reject His understanding, have no access to that base. And everything's speculation. You'll be a speculation. You'll be painted in the corner as something weird. But I tell you what, in my opinion, if you want to walk with Jesus, you're going to have to be someone who becomes trusted enough that you can learn to work on His base in Area 51. It's His great secrets that keep this universe together. And He looks to share His great secrets with His men and His women. He looks to reveal Himself, and He does it in this Area 51. He doesn't do it anyplace else. Why? Because it's a safe place. Now, you know I'm using a metaphor. I'm not talking about Southern Nevada. Please don't go buy a ticket. But get the ticket of the Spirit, that I need more of the Spirit. This place exists, and I want access to it. I'm not going to believe the phony theologians. They missed God when He was standing in front of them. They had thousands upon hundreds of thousands of volumes that they themselves had written, and they lost the living presence of God and no longer contained the breath of His Spirit. Jesus identified them that you're bookworms, full of men's thoughts, and Satan's your father. You're whitewashed sepulchres full of dead men's bones. You're snakes, you're vipers. That's what He thinks of the society of religious men that want to corner the market on His word without Him in it. He's got to be in it, or it's not His word. And His word consists of two things. Matter of fact, we did a passage of Scripture in chapter 2 of Proverbs. It talked about His word and His precepts. His word is His mouth speaking. His precepts is His law and His instruction. And He defines the difference in the two. And He makes the statement that we need both of those if we're going to gain the supernatural wisdom that only the Holy Spirit can get and give to us. So with that, we're going to reread this, maybe a little slower, and maybe expand some of the things, beginning in verse 17, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ and the Father of glory may give you a spirit of wisdom. What is that? Because many say, if the Holy Spirit is history, how can we receive a spirit of wisdom? If the Holy Spirit was just only active then how is the church supposed to be led by the Spirit today? The Holy Spirit was just a historical fact, like the ascension of Christ. That happened just once, did it not? Then why did Peter make the statement, this gift of the Holy Spirit you see is for you and for all generations hereafter that call upon the name of God? For all generations. I don't want this session to be just about the Holy Spirit, but us look and see. When he says a spirit of wisdom, we know the scripture talks about the seven spirits of God. There's the spirit of Christ, spirit of Jesus. Matter of fact, if you don't have the spirit of Jesus, then you don't belong to Jesus. Romans 8:9. You, however, are controlled not by the sinful nature, but by the spirit. If the spirit of God lives in you, and if anyone does not have the spirit of Christ, he does not belong to Christ. Did you catch that? There's two spirits mentioned there, spirit of God and the spirit of Christ. Jesus shows up on the scene, and he is the spirit of himself, the incarnation of God. But yet he goes down to John the Baptist, and when John baptizes him, what descends from heaven and enters him and becomes a part of him, according to Scripture, in the form of a dove? The Holy Spirit. Now we have two entities of the Godhead dwelling in one person. I've heard lots of people have difficulty with thinking that there's two different spirits. Well, this verse just point blank says it. And I can tell you, those who do not have the Spirit in Christ in them do not belong to Jesus. But now when we receive the Spirit of Christ, now he made us ready that we could receive the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit. Now, this wisdom or Sophia, it stands for imparted divine wisdom from God. I like that. I like it that it's not something that I just learn. Wisdom is of God. You realize wisdom says, I was there in the beginning when God reached out his hand and he made the universe. I watched him as he formed the mountains and the oceans. Wisdom was there when, and he goes through a whole list of things of wisdom standing there, the spirit of wisdom, seeing God do all these things. But the spirit of wisdom is somehow connected to the Holy Spirit and somehow connected to Christ, because the spirit of wisdom is, it's noted that the spirit of wisdom was Christ in that six passage of scriptures, that he, the spirit of wisdom, has come. Now, I want you to know the Godhead is all weaved in amongst itself. And I know we split him out into the triune God, which they are. He's identified himself. There's three different parts to him. He's identified himself. There's seven spirits of God. Some of these things are beyond most theologians' understanding, and I don't think you can find them out unless you really camp out in Area 51. But I want you to know this. Wisdom is God, Jesus, which he's the sole author of wisdom in 1 Corinthians 1:30. It's you conjoining with them with purity of heart and life in James 1:5 and 3:13 and 15. The wisdom of God means a divine wisdom, including the ideas of impartations of infinite skill and ability and insight and knowledge and purity. That's from, imparted from the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit moved upon the men to make the articles for trans-dimensional place called the tabernacle, that God would descend and be in the midst because of special holy articles that he imparted to them, special wisdom of how to make. We can't make those things. It's probably stored in Area 51. I'm having fun with Area 51. Fear of God is part of wisdom. It's generally the knowledge of how to regulate one's relationship with God. Wisdom, which is related to goodness, the knowledge and practice that we're supposed to be living upright before him. I want you to know that there's supreme intelligence that can be transmitted to you through this visitation of this spirit of wisdom that Paul is praying for us to receive. It's one thing for him to pray for it. It's another thing for you to see it and say, I want to receive it. I shared with the guys in last night's episode that being a receiver, that means you run to the far end of the football field and Jesus is throwing something to you. You got to see it to be able to catch it. Lord, I want that. I want your wisdom. Oh, come, Holy Spirit. Bring the wisdom of God. I need some supernatural understanding about my God. And the supernatural understanding enables you, through impartations, to begin to gain understanding of how to live a personal relationship in the presence of God. In the presence of God. Not in the presence of men. In the presence of God. Jesus lived before his Father. Everything he did was before his Father. Even when he looked up, he talked to the Father, and he says he saw the Father. Everything he did was to please the Father. That means he's standing in full view of the Father in everything that he does. With us, that spirit of wisdom and a spirit of revelation, if we go on and look at the definition of revelation, the 14th century dictionary, the act of revealing or communicating divine truth through the manifest power and presence of God. He's praying. We have a spirit of wisdom and a spirit of revelation. We need God revealed to us. So it is a true act on God's part of revealing himself, a true act on God's part of communicating to us divine truth. And how does that come? Through the manifest presence of the power of the Holy Spirit, that same power that raised Jesus Christ from the dead, now is at work trying to speak to us, to impart God's word to us, because his word is life-giving. His word brings his breath into us, which brings life and truth, and gives us encounters with our living God. New breath within us. You need more breath? You ever held your breath for a long time at the bottom of a swimming pool and come up and need breath? We need that spiritually. In the bottom of life, you swim around doing your work. I'm getting so tired. Okay, I got to go up. I got to get some air. I got to have air. See, that is the way we're supposed to be about in our need of having a spiritual revelation of God. I need a breath. Revelation is not a spooky thing, you wearing a tin hat with little antennas. Revelation means the things that God knows that are germane, that you need to know, he makes them manifest where? In Area 51. Doesn't make them manifest to the world. He only makes them manifest to those who are capable of handling his top secrets. That means you have to be a trusted, loved person to gain access. So Paul is praying. He said, I've heard of your faith, and oh, praise God, I haven't met you yet, but I hear you've met the living God. And here's what I'm praying. I've heard that you love the brothers too. That's one of the first signs of the Holy Spirit being poured out. And then he says, here's what I'm praying for you guys. You may not have had the fullness of these experiences, and you may not know they exist. But I'm telling you, as before God, this place exists. The spirit of wisdom exists. And I'm praying that you know about it. I'm praying you call upon him. I'm praying that the spirit of revelation overtakes you. Why? So that they can come into the knowledge of him. That's epigenos, and we'll get into that in a minute. Remember, we've been to epigenos before. Go back to Revelation. Something is revealed by God through the power of the Holy Spirit to humans. The act of revealing, to make, or to revealing to view or making known by God. Something that is revealed and made manifest. I love this. An apocalyptic experience with God, by God. Do you know what that means? That's a book of Revelation. The very word means revelation. Apocalyptic. And when he says that he's praying that the spirit of wisdom and a spirit of apocalyptic comes over you, in other words, hang on to your hat, because you might hear a voice that says, come up here, and you won't be in Area 51. You'll catch the elevator there, though. Now, that word is hypatsu in the Greek, which means come up here. And John, all of a sudden, is taken from Area 51, and he's standing in God's presence. He's giving account in the throne room. And he's, oh, there's God. And there's 24. They're taking their crowns off, and oh, they're, wow, oh, God. he can't even catch his breath, and he's having to record all this. And then he sees about the scrolls, and he sees the future of mankind, and he sees the great city, and he sees the great wars, and he's taken to several different time zones that take place throughout the future of history, all the way to the close of history, of seeing Jesus come as the great Messiah and great King to make war against our enemy, Satan. And you know what defeats Satan? He's defeated by the breath of the Lamb. And that breath is the same thing that's referred to as the Spirit. That's pneuma. That's why we need the pneuma that brings wisdom. We need the breath of Jesus. Breath of Jesus within us, fresh and new. Defeat Satan. I need more breath. I can only get that in Area 51. Going on in this explanation of Revelation, something revealed, made manifest. You know what manifest is? If I take a stick of dynamite, light it. When it goes off and you feel the impact, you see the blast, you see the flashing light, you hear your ears deafened and you're knocked 50 feet back, guess what happened? You received a manifestation from something. It was an experience on your part. You may not have lived over it if you were too close. Our God is supposed to be an experiential God that manifests himself. And then when he says that the spirit of this Sophia and the spirit of revelation, we're still in revelation. Look at this. Apocalyptus means revelation, by being revealed by God. Manifestation. I just told you that's the power of God being made known in our presence. His coming, his appearing, him laying bare and making transparent everything so it can be seen. It's a disclosure and revealing of divine truth and instruction concerning things before that were unknown, being now made known. It's a manifestation and an appearance. So when Paul is saying, he's saying, oh, dear saints there, my prayer for you is everything explodes. And the power of God manifests himself in your midst. I'm praying that he will come and you will have these kind of experiences. Now, if they did not believe, they would not have those kind of experiences. It's kind of like those people that don't believe Area 51 exists. They're not going to go there. They're not going to see what's there. They have no desire to go there. They have no desire to experience what's there. And there's things in there, there's technology in there that every computer buff on earth would love to get hold of, because it's 30 years advanced of what anything we see on the street right now. Stuff that's coming out on the street came out of the military, but it's 15 to 20 years old. And they say technology is doubling, I think, every 3 months now. Think how much technology's in that place. We don't know. But I'm telling you, there's that much technology spiritually in Area 51 of God that it can be multiplied and multiplied and multiplied unto you. And so Paul is trying to bring home an understanding. He says, I want your eyes to see it so you can understand it. In the next passage, that the eyes of your understanding might be enlightened, that you might know the hope of his calling and what the riches of his glory, of his inheritance in the saints, and that what is the exceeding greatness of his power. See, theologians today don't believe in that greatness of his power. If the Holy Spirit has no power and he was only a vent there, then there's no power for us to live a life of God today. The same power that resurrected Christ, it's going to take that to keep me honest. It's going to take that same power to keep me pure. It's going to take that same power and draw and magnetism of the greatness of God that enables me to live for my God. It takes that much power for me to make a decision. I want to become holy before you. It takes that much power for me to make a decision. I will believe in you. It takes power from him for me to receive faith, because faith is a gift from God. That same power that raised Jesus Christ from the dead and seated him on the throne is available to raise us from our spiritual death, where we do not know. See, spiritually dead means you're unaware of the presence of God. You're unable to commune and walk with him. You're unable to hear his voice. You're unable to receive his directives and direction other than something that was written. We're supposed to hear his voice. My sheep hear my voice. Now, can you be led if you can't hear his voice? He doesn't want you to go run and have to get a book. The whole gift of God's wisdom. There's a gift of wisdom that can be poured out upon you. I gave this little illustration, and if you guys can bear with me on this, I'll give it again. I was in Arkansas. We had taken this troop of kids there to retreat for youth camp, and it was kind of a dude ranch and up on the hillside, and all trees and kind of mountains around there. And it was right outside Eureka Springs, and took them to see the Passion Play. And some of the other youth pastors had taken the whole troop to town, and I had a couple hours off, and I said, I'm going to go horseback riding. And I go in, and I look, I hate those old dust nags that get the hump in the back that's going down, and they just kind of droop along and drag their feet. And I went in, and I looked at one that's got some flaring nostrils, and he's wanting to giddy up, and I'm wanting to giddy up. I'm a young guy at the time, and not a super horseman by any means, but I had enough strength that I think I could hang on. I could just hang on. May have to choke that horse down, but we're going to go where I want him to go. Well, it was real good. First, got him out of the gate, and he's dead run for about 2.5 miles. I mean, dead run. He was invigorating. His nostrils were flaring, and he... I think, okay, go for it, horse. I keep him, kept him on kind of a path, and got out there and wandered around the hills and stuff, and just kind of walking back, And finally start coming back. He gets about a mile from the barn, and he sees that barn. And the barn's not in line with the road. I got a problem. There's a bunch of trees in between the line of sight, and they're low trees. And he sees that barn, and all of a sudden you hear this, and boom! I mean, he's like he's got a rocket on his tail, and he is on fire, and he's cutting cross country under those trees, and I'm leaning completely over on that saddle. Limbs are shrinking by and all this stuff, and I see another tree coming, and I reach up. I'm hanging on. I got this leg hanging on the top of the saddle. I'm hanging, and I reach up, and I grab those reins, and I pull that horse's head all the way back to the saddle, and he's still dead run. He's not giving up. I got his nose. His eyeball's looking right at me, because I got him pulled, strained right back. That big old nostril's right there next to the saddle going, another tree comes flying by, and the next thing I know, he's starting to skid over. Now, what I need here is an act of a gift of grace. It's not time I need to pray for wisdom. I need the gift of wisdom poured out upon me. And I literally heard my God say, when this horse starts going down, you grab hold of the horn of that saddle, and the second he starts flipping over, you grab that and jerk that as hard as you can to the left until it's on his belly. I said, yes, Lord. I grabbed that horn. I jerked that as hard as I could. That horse is probably doing 30 miles an hour, and he's down on his side, and he's just skidding about 70 feet. Brush flying by, leaves, dirt, junk flying by, and I'm, he's sliding. And we finally stop. And the horse is nearly upside down. I'm sitting in the middle of the saddle, still straight up and down, on his belly. Now, if you need a gift of wisdom, it's different than us praying for wisdom. Oh, God, I need wisdom. I didn't have time to pray for wisdom. I had to be prayed up. I had to be in Area 51 to get the download of the grace. You need wisdom, my son. And God poured out liberally wisdom that saved my life. My point in telling you this, God's power is available in every circumstance of our life. God's power is available in every situation that we're in. Not only is His power available, but when it talks about the same power that resurrected Christ, it's talking about the same power that keeps the presence of Christ. Isn't that right? He took Him out of the place of death, and where did He resurrect Him to the Father? And where did Jesus say, "I'll never leave you, I'll forsake you, I'll always be with you, where two or three are gathered in My name, I will come and be in your nets"? That same power is here so that we can have manifest, revelational experiences with our living God. But you got to be an employee of Area 51 if you want those. Not available for the self-theologian that knows everything about Scripture out there. Experience is only available for those, because see, the spirit of wisdom and the spirit of revelation, what are they for? It's to bring us into the epigenos of Him. And what is epigenos? In the Greek, give you a definition there. It's to recognize. It is more than gnos. See, gnos is knowledge. Actually, you just pick up a book on the shelf. Pull out the Bible. That's gnos. Knowledge about God. You can have an experience with the information that you read in there, but it itself is just gnos. So this, it's more than gnos. It's more than knowledge, because it expresses a more thorough participation in real experience in acquiring of the knowledge on the part of the learner. You catch that? Participation, experience. I'm the learner. You're the learner. Epigenos is not gnos. It goes on in their definitions. In the New Testament, it often refers to the experiential knowledge, which is very powerful. It influences the outcome of your life. It's a knowledge laying claim to personal involvement with God on an experiential level, with use as an object. In other words, Ephesians 1:17, 4:13, I give you a whole list of passages of Scripture there of relational functionality with God. Jesus showing up, experiences, Peter and Paul, and all the different experiences they had when they're singing in the jail, and the great earthquake occurs, and angels walk in and rescue. They're in epigenos. The whole church lived in epigenos, not in gnos. Matter of fact, the Gnostics, they were handlers of gnos. The Gnostics, they wrote all these Gnostic so-called gospels about knowledge and how knowledge is God. And the knowledge of God, they were the apostles of the knowledge of God. They were recognized as heretics and didn't know God. They were sent away from the church, sent out as heretics. Let's go on back to our definition here. It shows a relationship of the learner to and in God, which is the object of his experiential knowledge. The object is not that we live a life. The object is we have experience with our God. That's the whole object of you being here. Whole object of me being here, to have an experience with my God. The real experience an individual has incurred spiritually, blessing, increasing spiritual blessings by and from God upon the believer. Ephesians 1:17, 2 Peter 1:2-3. And this determines the continuing manifestations of God in the life of the believer. Did you realize that? Once you get a taste and you see God is real. You know, once I had a taste and I heard a voice in the back seat saying, "Drive, trust me. I'm the one, I'm your God. I can put gas in your tank." Once that happened, now it triggers within me. Do I take that as knowledge and turn it into, through experience of doing it, epigenos? I heard, it's just knowledge. I drive and experience my God doing it. Now it's epigenos. That precipitated 2 days later after he continued to do that. Another thing, me sitting in the laundromat, dropping my coins in the last coins in the washer and in the dryer and out of money. That precipitated God speaking, and out of Him speaking, Him saying, "I'm your provider," and there's a bunch more to the story. And then the money, the whole dryer being filled with money, enough to live on for 2 weeks. There's the epigenos of the experience. Why? God speaks to me and says, "I'm your provider." That's knowledge. The money coming in the dryer, that's epigenos. Now, my faith in my God, my trust in Him that you're here, the reality of Him, you're here. You're my living God. How do I get to Area 51? I started looking for Area 51. How do I learn to hear you? Where are you camped out? How do I make this connection? Where are your deepest secrets? How do I learn to live with you? How do I learn to hear your voice? And I want to fall head over heels in love with you. I can't live without you. Epigenos is the only thing that does that, not knowledge. Men with the knowledge of Scripture killed millions upon millions of people in Europe in the Dark Ages. Men, the Protestant Reformation said, "Hey, the Catholic Church no longer in charge, we're in charge, and we are taking all these towns, and anybody that doesn't convert dies." And now every town that has converted, even if you're a murderer and a rapist and you're still a thief and all that stuff, every one of you better be in church because every one of you is a Christian. I'm serious. And there was a whole society called anti-Baptist that said, "Wait a minute, God is the one that calls His people into His church. And you can't baptize a rapist that's continuing to do that, that has no intention to turn to God. And you can't call him a Christian. We're not going to join in with that. God calls His people." There was a whole reformation of people that withdrew from that. Matter of fact, I think it's called the Stepchildren something another book. What's the name of that, Jackie?
Stepchildren of the Reformation.
It'll really open your eyes to some things that went on. Because it was a people even back then that knew how to walk with God. My whole point in giving you this scenario is because they wanted again to use knowledge to rule people. Knowledge to make people godly. Knowledge never made anyone godly. Experiential knowledge, epigenos, is what changes us. Many people say, "Okay, accept the knowledge that Jesus Christ is God. And I accept Him as my Lord." Where's the experience? It was supposed to turn into epigenos. Jesus is supposed to enter into you. There was supposed to be a real spiritual thing that happened on a spiritual level of Jesus entering into somebody, not because of some words that they said, but because of some truth that entered them, of the revelation of God, and God revealing Himself, and Jesus coming in and saying, "This is my new home. You belong to me. I am in you." And it says every person who receives the Spirit of Christ, their life changes, and you can tell by the details in their life whether they belong to Christ or not. Does it not say that in Scripture? There's many out there that call themselves Christians that are not. The details of their life say, "I am not." But we can examine the truth of Scripture. Those who have received Christ are molded into His image, and they come away from sin, is what the Scripture says. Those who continue to do sin, Jesus says, "I don't know you. If you continue in sin, there remains no more sacrifice," is what the Scripture says. That's not falling in the mud hole. That's not falling in the pig pen. That's you still being a pig and wanting to be in the pig pen. If you want to be in the pig pen, then that means you're a pig. If you want out of the pig pen, that means God can clean you up and turn you into a sheep. You have to get the little ring out of your nose first. But you got to stop rooting in the hog trough. Now, let's go on here, back to our definitions of epigenos, because Paul is just hammering this home. The Holy Spirit's hammering it home, saying, "Oh, power of God, all of this is wrapped up for you to have experience." It gives Romans 1:28 and Colossians 3. It gives us a more precise definition as knowledge, which is God. It's God determined. His manifestations, he determines to do. It's God regulated so that man doesn't regulate that. So that the difference is mentioned in 3:10. And what it's talking about here in Colossians 3, it's talking about there God, if he's in it, he's going to manifest himself. Because he's the one that decided to do that. He wants to reveal his power. And Paul is praying that their eyes would be opened to be able to enter into these kind of experiences. Now, I want to continue on in this definition. It refers to the knowledge which enable ones to avoid losing the ability to commune with God. Do you know what it's like to lose the ability to commune with God? See, David, he sins with Bathsheba. God sends a death angel. There's thousands of Israelis that are dying. He quickly goes up and buys a threshing floor and offers a sacrifice to God. My point in giving you that is he didn't want to lose his ability to commune with God, because later on in one of the Psalms that he wrote, "Oh God, do not take your Holy Spirit from me." Most important thing to him in life. He was willing to take the judgments of God on his household. He was willing to let the throne be taken. He was willing to die. He was willing to do anything. But, "Oh God, don't take your Holy Spirit from me." He's crying out. Why? It's because he had lived in an epigenos life with God. God would come. The Spirit would come. And it was an amazing thing for a young lad to be set on fire by the Spirit of God. Amazing thing for him to receive the knowledge. "Don't be afraid of that giant over there. I'm your God. Go slay him." "Yes, I heard the knowledge." Goes out. He says, "No, just take the rock. You don't need all that garbage that Saul's trying to put on. You don't need that. Take the rocks." And he goes out, and now the Holy Spirit comes over him, and God's speaking to him. He said, "Tell this ogre that is profaning my name." and David unloads on him. "Who are you think you can speak against a great and mighty God? I'm going to cut your head off before this day is over." And he just, this little kid, takes his sling out and poof. Why? He turns knowledge, because God is present, into epigenos. Your life is supposed to go from knowledge that's received to the Spirit of wisdom, then into revelation that God is revealing this to you. It's a truth. Now, since it's a truth and it's knowledge from the Spirit, let's live it out. Let's experience our great God. When our heart is ready for that experience and we desire that experience, but we got to get the wisdom, the Spirit of wisdom, right? And we need the Spirit of revelation, because you're not going to get into Area 51 without those two things. That's your secret pass keys. The Spirit of wisdom does not come unless you have faith in your God, loving him, realizing you're here. You're really here, oh God. And Paul is writing to the church in Ephesus saying, you're running after God, and he's real. Have experiences with him. And begins to articulate to them the type of experience that they have. Now, Paul had been there. They had walked in that, but he's been gone for some time. There's been new people on the block that come in that have not had experiences. That's why in one passage of Scripture, he makes a statement, even though you haven't seen him yet. Some theologians say, "Oh, see there, they're not seeing him." That's true. But what was his whole purpose in writing the letter? That they would see him. He acknowledged, you haven't seen him yet, but you will behold him. Now, some theologians push that all the way to the end time. I disagree with that. Because I disagree with that, I'm from Roswell. But I live in Area 51. I'm familiar with the turf, and I don't care what men out there say. I walk with my God. I walk with him living in this life. He's my provider. He's my sustainer. He is my living God. And in that, he delights my heart. And it is a great pleasure when I look at his word. I said, "Oh, Lord, I hadn't been doing that. Oh, forgive me." It gives me pleasure to want to do that. We're supposed to have delight when we find something in the word that we're not doing. It's not supposed to, "Oh, I have to stop doing that. No. It's a delight to do God's will. Why? Because it's not knowledge. It's epigenos. I want to move into those experiences. I can only do that if I listen to the Spirit of Wisdom. The Spirit of Wisdom comes and says, would you do this? It will help strengthen you spiritually. That may mean getting up at a certain hour and really sincerely praying, giving up some time. It may mean not doing some things. Not for God, for myself. A Spirit of Wisdom is willing to speak on every subject that he wants to speak on, not on the subject I want to speak on. And there's part of the problem with our ear. We don't have our ear tuned to hear what he has to say. Instead, we have our ear tuned of our outcries of, here's the prayers I need answered. That's all we're listening for, is those answers. If those are the only answers you're listening for, then it's like, I don't know, there's these weird big antennas that are in different places across the world that they've put up to listen. Is there anybody out there talking? Some of those are hundreds of feet across, staring up into space. Is there anything out there communicating? Is there any other intelligence out there? They didn't have to build that antenna. Wrong antenna. Here's the antenna, the Word of God, God's presence, the epigenos of our God. And he will make his wisdom known to us. Now, when he does this, it causes the eyes of your understanding to be enlightened. When I realized my God was here on earth, because I had him pegged that he was somewhere up there. Did y'all pray up there, or do you pray down here? And it took me a long time to get used to. I would forget he's here. Big problems would come up, and, you know, oh, God, oh, would you move? Would you do something? And, you know, I'm back to praying up there. I've done that one time. I've said this a few times, and it's worthy of saying again. I literally was praying, and I felt something whisk past my ear, and I opened my eyes and saw a finger sticking out in a hand. Why are you praying up there? I said I would never leave you and I'd never forsake you. When will you learn I'm here? I just fell on my face in tears. Because I forget my God is here. I forget it's supposed to be experiential. See, if he's not here, then I have no duty of communing with him and loving him. Instead, it's a God up there that I want to perform for me, for my needs. Instead, he wants to remind me, I'm here for fellowship, Curtis. Are you a faithful wife to me? Do you keep your house clean for me? You keep your attitudes clean for me. You keep your heart clean for me. You get up in the morning and bake fresh bread for me or for you? You get up in the morning and see to your household chores for me or for you? Or do you see to those chores for some other reason? My thought wrapped around this is that we're his bride, and I have a wonderful bride. Occasionally she forgets to do something. Or perhaps I've loaded up her little donkey cart with so much she doesn't have the time. But I come in and I look and see, well, why isn't there breakfast? And okay, I'll be silent. But as she knows, to me, the most precious time in life is my family. I was raised, the breakfast hour is the most precious time that there was. If she's not performing that, I have to look at myself and, Lord, am I not finding out what you want and when you want it? Am I not being your bride? Do I not serve it the way you want? I must not. I catch a lot of reflections and things I want to point out as error to Jackie. I catch those same reflections in me and my relationship to my King. And so I've learned to restrain some of my ignorance and think about it, of how am I failing in my duties and responsibilities in my relationship with my Lord. all that comes because of a lack of consciousness of Him being here. If you carry a conscious mind, Lord, You're sitting beside me. What is Your wishes in this? If you have a conscious mind of His presence, it puts a totally different spin on everything that happens during the day. When I lose that perspective, and my God's up in the clouds, now I'm busy about my own life doing my own thing, I lost consciousness of Him. And now I can only live in Gnos. I'm no longer in Area 51. Area 51 is personal relationship with God. The Holy Spirit came to bring us into a state that we could have personal relationship with Him, loving Him, hearing Him, Him being our best friend, our great King that never disappoints, feeling His intense love. That is our great King who has made Himself available. So I would say that the spirit of wisdom and revelation are for one purpose, to bring epigenos experience. Most of us pray for wisdom about some business contract, not wisdom of how to move closer to God. Wisdom about what do I do about my family and what do I do about my house payment, and instead of, oh God, I need supernatural revelation of You. I need some Area 51 training and experiences. We don't pray for those kind of wisdom things to happen to us. And as a result, we lack an epigenos. And if we lack an epigenos, there's many areas of our life that just seem humdrum. Just seem like we can't get there and never get ahead. Our focus is always on the wrong things. I had a problem with, I don't know, some blood pressure or something today. My eyes were pounding and my head was pounding. Not in the sense of a headache, but in the sense of like a balloon being blown up and everything was shifting on me physically in my eyes, you know. And the same thing with my thoughts. I had difficulty focusing. When we are not in epigenos with God and just in knowledge, it's just little bits and pieces that we catch of Him, like listening to a phone conversation that's not fully connected. Epigenos means you're fully connected and you're in it. It's not a phone conversation anymore. Have you prayed for a spirit of wisdom and revelation so you can know Him more? Know Him more. That's the purpose of it. Know Him more. I don't find many Christians that ever thought about that. Instead, they're praying for wisdom and revelation about life. Our heart's cry in this session should be focus and begin to cry out, moan, come up for air, and I've got to have air. Should be, I need You, Holy Spirit, to bring new wisdom so that I can commune with my God. A new revelation of Him to stir and get my heart going. I mean, do we need to get out the paddles and put on your chest and holler, clear, and push the button and the lights dim to get the heart going? The heart's supposed to be responsive to God. The heart's supposed to be pumping for Him. We're supposed to be full of zeal for Him, running after Him with everything that's within us. If we're not, that means the heart beats out of sync. I need the Holy Spirit to come. I pray, put 50 million volts in it. Wake me up out of my stupor. Wake me up out of my sleep. I want back in Area 51 with my living God. Shall we pray? Lord, Your hidden secrets and truths are ready to be made manifest to us who walk in the Spirit. You say so in Your word. All this message is so hard for the theologians and so hard for those in Gnos. They have no experience and understanding that revelational experiences are here and now, and the power of God is present. And, oh Lord, if any of those little things are within us that somehow disables our faith to believe that your manifest power and presence is ready and willing and waiting to be poured out in this day and time, then, oh God, I ask, number one, that you forgive us, and number two, that you strengthen us, and number three, I pray that we need wisdom so we can have the revelation of you. We need wisdom so we can move into epigenos, so that we'll never again fade back and say, well, I don't know if God does those things anymore. There is nothing you can't do. You're not a historical event that occurred several thousand years ago. You're a living God in our midst. So help us to learn how to live with you. In Jesus' precious name I pray. Amen. Amen. Area 51. Pat's waiting with the microphone. Not going to take it in prayer format. If you'd like to make proclamation before your Lord, what he's expressed to you out of this teaching, how he's shared his heart with you, what revelation he's given you, what truth he's revealed to you, express yourself to him. Establish the ground that you'll walk on in the future by your proclamations of what you hear him speak. Yes.
All evening tonight through the worship, and even before we started to worship, and especially through the word, I became more and more and more aware of the great distance he has come to meet me, to meet us. And how now I need to come that same distance back in his direction. And I've prayed these prayers, but I don't think I've prayed him and asked for the zeal and the power and the strength of spirit to press into him experientially. And I pray and I ask for that now, and ask forgiveness for becoming rather passive this last year in some of this. And I feel it's time to stir up the spirit inside and become passionate, more passionate.
Amen. Amen. Anyone else?
I too feel the same, that there's a stirring going on. And I really, over the last 6 months, have really had some things before the Lord about my own walk. And I've asked the Lord, the one thing that has brought real fear of God in me is I do not want to walk in presumption. I want to walk in faith. And faith is being connected. Faith is not some abstract out there. It's being connected to a real live person. And the last few weeks, things have begun to stir. This Bible study we're doing on Tuesdays is incredible, because it's really breaking the fallow ground. It's breaking things away from me, things that I have believed that were lies. And so tonight, when I hear this, there's a real stirring going on in me, and a real awareness of what epigenos really is. And yeah, I used to live there. Well, I want to live there again. And God knows my heart. He knows where I'm going and what he's going to do in me with this. I ask his forgiveness, because I know that I sat on my hands and not said a lot of things. And I believe that was wisdom in its time. But there's a time now when many of us are going to begin to speak what he gives us in season. To his glory. Amen. To his glory.
Anyone else?
What I realized tonight is that there's a lot of things that that I don't understand, or I have unbelief in, that I try to understand with my own mind, and I realize that I need the spirit of revelation and the spirit of wisdom. It's not trying to wrap it around my own mind, but it's asking for those things.
Anyone else?
Just today, I felt had such a stale feeling, as if there wasn't revelation, manifestation of my Lord. And I was hesitant. I heard that I have had enough, and that I shouldn't ask for more, should be satisfied with what I have. I didn't feel that that was right, but I just didn't understand exactly, and I kind of questioned all of that. But I'm just so thankful for this word tonight, because drown me, Lord, in epigenos. Drown me, because I want all of that. And I don't have to be feeling as if that I'm asking for too much, because I don't have to feel that way. My Lord wants to give me that, and I just thank him so much, because I want more. Thank you. Thank you for that.
Anyone else? Jacqueline. Jackie.
One of the scriptures that was brought out in our Bible study this week was, or this past week was, in Isaiah, and it said that that man's wisdom and understanding warps us. That was the translation in the New King James, that it warps us. And then the NIV, it was it leads us astray. And I, from that, and the, but even more so from what you shared today, I realized that it's that the default is that we will lean onto our own understanding, our own wisdom, or what we think is wisdom or knowledge or whatever, rather than asking for it. And no wonder, like James says, that we're double-minded in all our ways if we lack wisdom. And I just realized that I don't want to just I want to be proactive about praying for wisdom and revelation, rather than just kind of walking in the default, because the default is my own, and that's going to lead me astray or warp me. And so I need to be more proactive.
Amen. Anyone else? Last call, if that Lord spoke to you. Yes, Elton.
I just want to testify tonight and affirm that I heard the Lord, and that this whole matter of walking more in the power of His Spirit and into revelational experiences with Him, it's not just a one-time event, it's a process. And I've tried to make it an event where just now I ought to be experiencing this. Well, it's like the blind boy that saw men like trees walking, and Jesus continued to pray for him, and his vision became clearer and clearer and sharper and sharper. And I see that happening in me, and I just want to affirm that to the Lord, that I'm standing in agreement with you. I'm walking more and more into that, and I just it was revelation to me tonight to see that it is an ongoing process for me.
Amen. Anyone else?
It may have had to do with your words at the very beginning of the service, which touched me deeply. The words about the Lord's sacrifice for us. which moved into worship. And when I was in worship, I sang all those words differently because I became aware on a revelational level for me what I was, what an incredible privilege it was to be able to sing those words, to say those words out loud. And do you need a drink? Okay, all right. Okay. I just felt bad talking while you were choking. Okay. I hear you. Okay. I realized, and I'm just saying it because it was kind of an epigenos event for me. I realized to be able to stand here and sing those words to the Lord, that He made that possible for me to do that. That 23 years ago, He turned this sad person into a completely new creature. Completely. And that I've been able to live that experience. You should feel lots better. Forgot where I was. That's okay. I was just going to say that it, for me, it's an epigenos experience to view the past 23 years of my life and realize that all during that time and now, He has constantly revealed His work in me to me. And I was so aware of that during worship and what you brought to our attention before worship.
Guarantees, but don't let yourself be held back. Last call. Lord, your word is absolutely amazing. The expressions of your heart to us, your invitations into true fellowship beyond our comprehension. Your truths, oh, how we want to be a holder of those. Pray for spiritual mind to be able to receive them, Lord. Got to have a spiritual mind to be able to handle the spiritual wisdom that you're going to bring. Help us live our lives out before you as you transform us and give us that mind so that we can receive your spirit and your revelation. Oh, I thank you. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Final comments, yours? Any announcements? Anyone out there? Y'all still awake?